This is the world's most uncomfortable chair.
Right, we're off.
Nicknames, Jimmy, bunch I can't say.
Beano, Wombat for a while there. Smurf, because I'm so little.
Been known as Half Pint.
Moley, because I don't have the greatest eyesight.
Cuda, out of the Dukes of Hazzard. SailGP, show two. Ready, set.
Mark it.
Wildest guy in the water.
Have to give it to Phil Robertson.
Phil Robertson. I guess Phil Robertson.
Phil Robertson.
It has to be Phil.
You don't want to think about it. Easy.
Am I being thrown out there a lot?
Phil Robertson's a bit of a renegade master, I guess you could say. He's fast and loose. You know, he takes no prisoners when he gets out on the water.
He pushes it, but you know, look where it's got him. Top of the leaderboard after Taranto and just off the podium in Plymouth.
I'd say I'm quite fiery. I can get upset every now and then at the crew.
Board down. Get that board down.
And at the competitors as well.
What are you doing? What a reckless animal.
And sometimes the umpires, but we all know about that, don't we?
This is the umpires. Spain, you have been black flagged.
Black flags! Out of the race! Black flag.
Rubbish. That is rubbish. They could have get to us, umpire.
I've come from a match racing background, which I guess it breeds a bit of aggression. If there is a gap, I'm going to push for it, and if there's an opportunity, I'm going to go for the kill.
Don't do it, Nathan. Serious, mate.
When you see the Spanish boat coming your way, you always are prepared.
Don't do it, Phil!
And I get it too. You know, he's been sort of swapped around teams. He's trying to make a mark for himself. He's actually had to push to really get out there and take some chances to get some of the results.
He's done it so many times, he just keeps doing it.
I think it's important to have a bit of fire in your belly because at the end of the day, you're out there to win races.
Phil's a chippy character, isn't he?
Last of every start.
It's like a big grey hair. Yeah. Chest hairs.
Hashtag impossible, mate.
He's got a great sense of humour. I enjoy his banter.
Un, dos, tres, cuatro, cinco, seis. That's it. That's as far as the song goes.
Yeah. 130 or 120.
He's done a fantastic job in season two of taking this group of young Spanish F50 rookies and turning them into a really good team. All the while knowing that he's going to be handing over the wheel for season three to Jordi Zamar, the young Spanish sailing superstar.
First time I jumped on the F50 as six sailor. I was behind Phil. And in that reach, I was like, what the hell am I doing here? Like, it was like bloody windy, and I was like, what? Why do that? You say yes. You just feel like a lot of G-force is going, like you don't have much control of your body. But at the same time, it was so much fun. My father was coming from the racing motorbikes. He didn't want that for me because obviously it's a real dangerous sport. And now when my father saw those boats flying, he was like, I wasn't expecting that the boats would just take off and go 100 kilometers per hour.
So we're heading into Aarhus, the fourth event, and Spain have had a great start, but they're now pretty mid-table.
Their Olympic sailors are back, so the team's really flying high, but it's at that moment that their world's about to turn upside down.
Rounding up in 3, 2, 1.
As I dropped the board, I sort of knew that this was going to be really loaded. And as I started to turn, and the board just snapped. That's not really where you want to start on a race weekend, is riding the boat off before race day one.
Coming into Aarhus, Denmark SailGP team, who are well supported by Rockwell, they've got a lot to prove.
I think the expectation for our performance in Aarhus was less than we had on ourselves. You know, I remember meeting a lot of media and people, and they all said that, you know, it's great that you're here, just enjoy it, your time will come. But I had the feeling that our time was now. You know, we wanted to be on that podium.
Clear start there, and Sehested comes diving through the middle. Erling doing a good job, but a slight mistake. The hull touches down, and Sehested's ready to grab the opportunity.
D
Denmark has the lead.
This is an unusual place for the Danish team to be in.
It's going to come down to this final tack in here. Can Ainsley stick it? Oh, no, they fluff the tack.
And as they come to the line, it will be Denmark claiming the win in front of the home crowd.
So after the fairy tale start for Denmark, their challenge faded. Great Britain and Australia, really solid, all but booking their place in the final.
But the third spot was really up for grabs. The wind was starting to drop away, it was looking a bit lighter. And in those conditions, all eyes turned to one man, the Wind Whisperer.
On the foils, Nathan Outeris, the Wind Whisperer. There he goes, look at he glides through. Where's he found that from?
And we knew. We needed some good points to make the top three.
Japan has gone from seventh. They will jump up into first. Look at that, he's lapping France and Australia. It is Japan getting the win in race number five, and Ben Ainsley will take second place.
Got ourselves out of jail.
You put Slingsby, Outeridge, Ainsley in a three-way winner-take-all final, and that is pure box office.
There's the start gun. Here we go. And it's Australia across the line first. Ainsley a little bit late at the bottom of the line.
We didn't have a great start. We came in late. We were hoping for more wind. The wind shut off. But then we got back into the race pretty well. Made some gains on the first upwind leg. And then we, of course, had this incident with Team Japan.
Are we crossing GBR? Probably Japan have got room at the mark. Probably happened, mate. Just got to give them.
Yeah, they do. They will have room. We're giving them enough at the moment.
We had to give Japan room because even though they were on the giveaway tack, they had the inside overlap at the mark.
This is the umpire's penalty, GBR, relative to Japan, not giving room at the mark, not giving room at the mark.
That's a big, big call by the umpire.
How much room do they want? That is such a big call.
It was clear we weren't crossing Ben. It was clear we had to duck him. We thought if Ben doesn't give us enough space, there's going to be contact. And so we just thought we'll push the penalty flag and we'll see if the umpires think there was enough space or not.
Maybe Japan have got room at the mark.
We gave them room. We felt that whatever they had decided to do, they had enough room. Clearly, the umpires thought differently.
That's just such a ridiculous call. Like, we just gave them so much room.
Let's go, Wink. We're going to have to get behind them here.
Hey, Craig, are they going to take their penalty? Shut up, Nathan. Mate, that's a call. We're going to try and get behind you. Stop moaning.
You're in the heat of battle, and when it doesn't go your way, naturally, as human beings, we vent. And Ben vented.
You've got no idea what you're talking about. I think it makes a good TV, doesn't it?
Well, you know, I mean, I still think it was a terrible umpire call. I mean, the umpire and I, you know, agree to disagree.
No way you can claim that he wouldn't have gone for the same penalty.
Oh, yeah.
When he shouted at us, you know, Chris Draper was next to me and he just giggled straight away. He just said, oh, you've upset Ben now. You better watch out.
I guess I really shouldn't have poked the bear. I'd be worried about getting beaten up after that.
When you're racing, that's one thing. And when you finish the race and you get back on shore, you know, you might have a disagreement about things, but it's not personal.
It's all forgotten until the next time they have an incident on the water. Don't worry, it's not forgotten. They might say it's forgotten, it'll be remembered, I think.
What a race that was. Outeridge looks like he's done enough to secure second.
Ben Ainsley not happy in third, but congratulations, Australia, SailGP for the victory in Aarhus.
Ben Dog, go for it, mate.
Well, as the F50's evolved, the data and the analysis that wraps around it has evolved with it. But it's a Pandora's box. Treat it with respect, and it can be the difference between winning and losing. But let yourself get lost in the numbers, and you can be out of control really quickly.
Every tenth of a second, each boat generates 2,200 channels of data, and there are 8 boats in the fleet. So that's a tsunami of data coming at you. I doubt there's any other sport that creates 4 billion lines of data every time we go racing. Any point that they can actuate on has a sensor. So rotation of the wing, they can measure how high they are flying. You know to the exact tenth of a second when someone pushed the button. One of the particularities of a SailGP is that data is shared. Every team can have a look at other teams' data, which is kind of unique in any competitive sport.
I can go and have a chat with Chris Draper and
You know, we can have an open conversation about how we're setting up the wing because there's no hiding. That's what the data sharing brings, is this kind of almost collaborative gain from everyone.
The coach can share information with the boat. They have a window between the end of a race and the start of the next one. He can look on his tablet and just give that feedback.
And you know where you exited off Jimmy, and Jimmy continued in?
Yeah.
And you...
I can get quite lost in the numbers. I can start digging into some info and completely go down all different rabbit warrens.
There was that practice start one where the Kiwi started under us. You know, we're at 90 and they're at 105.
What we do at Team Australia is we're really targeted in our approach to the data.
He reckoned that they are steering a little bit more going into the manoeuvre.
From my point of view, I'm looking, oh, what are they doing with the camber at that point in the wing? And the GBR boat's manoeuvring very nicely there. What are they doing? When are they switching their foils?
You need to try to not create questions you don't have and not try to go to the data and find a miracle, because it's not going to happen.
At the end of the day, the data doesn't cover everything. You know, no one can copy what your brain's thinking in the race.
SailGP is also looking to use innovation to help drive positive environmental change and to further sustainability.
The whole development of race operations and our turning marks started off where we had mark set box for the Inspire program. And what that is it allows a race officer to plug in the GPS coordinates of where the turning marks are. Then that turning mark will drive by an electric powered solution to the position and hold station without having to anchor, without having to risk damaging the ocean floor, without having to use any petrol engine to get into position. So it saves a lot of resources and reduces the carbon footprint enormously.
So starting next season, the GP bot is designed to be the race markers for the F50 course. Self-powered and autonomous, it has a large lithium ion battery on it. The beauty of that is we have a partnership with a solar company, and so we're able to charge and truly run off-grid with the GP bot.
Our race director can be sitting in Sydney, Australia, and position the marks. If the wind changes and he has to reset the course, he can just plug in new coordinates and the course is reset. So it's pretty amazing technology.
Nah, look, I honestly, I don't believe in bad luck.
Bang! Crash down! Jimmy Spittle stopped!
Any more bad luck?
For the USA team, 2021 has been a tough year. Jimmy Spithill's series of unfortunate events has been every bit the TV drama.
Heads up, heads up, heads up!
Hold. Bermuda.
Collision with Japan.
Can I get it off here?
Out.
Got my rudder day.
Taranto.
Big impact.
Hitting an underwater object.
Out.
Lock her in, boys.
Plymouth.
Rudder issues.
Come on.
Last in the final.
Aarhus.
Big injury.
Pretty gnarly.
It's just incredible. If I was Jimmy Spittle, I would not want to walk outside in a lightning storm.
I mean, look, you never ever see an issue with someone when you're winning and when times are good. But when you have to face some, you know, some real challenges out there, some things going against you, then you really see if you've got the right people around you. And Paul Campbell-James is the perfect example of the person that really signifies, you know, Team USA.
The Americans are capsizing. Oh, goodness!
Team USA almost puts it over.
We went for the roundup and basically just lost control. And it kind of catapulted me when I hit the outside of my right leg. Carried on, finished the race and jumped in the medic boat, and the medic felt my leg and was like, yeah, you've broken your fibula. Five doctors said, not going to be in a boat for 6 weeks. Saint-Tropez was 21 days away. The doctor I eventually saw, who's a really big SailGP fan, which was a big help, he said to me, there is a chance that you could make this back. We'd have to operate on it now. I probably pushed it a little hard, but I had to prove to myself more than anything that I was going to be okay for Saint-Tropez.
In Formula One, it's Monaco, and in SailGP, it's Saint-Tropez. The glitz, the glamour, it's the best drivers in the world, duking it out, boat on boat, high speed on a short, tight circuit.
France Sail Grand Prix from Saint-Tropez, up on the foils, great stuff, and it looks like Jimmy Spittle come through from third place. He's up into the lead. Look at the speed on board the US boat. Jimmy Spittle, victory in race number two.
Here comes Jimmy Spittle and the Americans. Well, the pit bulls hunted him down. Spittle should get the inside at this turning mark, and that will give a lead change. And the Americans will make it 2 for 2 here in Saint-Tropez.
Nice, boys. Nice day, lads.
Well, it's the end of day one, and the forecast for the wind to drop. So SailGP decides to change it up.
And Russell Coutts drops the bombshell. Guys, it's time to bring out the big gear, the 29-metre wing.
So there was a lot of discussion. Some of the teams felt that they weren't accustomed to the big wing. But I felt, well, you know, these are the best sailors in the world. They should be able to handle this.
Everyone was like, oh, this is going to be a disaster. You know, Russell's putting us on these big wings. No one's trained with them. No one knows what we're going to get.
What's always been the elephant in the room for us, the fearful one, has been the 29. It's never been sailed on an F50 before. The wing height to boat size ratio is out of proportion to anything that's been designed before.
The beauty of this racing is, you know, it's not like one F1 driver gets a certain tyre compound and the other guy gets a different one. Everyone's got the same. So there can't be any complaining or any excuses about what wing size or what foils. Everyone is on the same.
As we get set for race number 5 of the France Sail Grand Prix, the big feature today are those massive wings.
Race 5, and Ben Ainslie and the British team have got it all to do to make the final.
Ben doubles down, he goes for broke, and it's all or nothing if he's going to make the final.
Great Britain coming, diving into the fleet.
Up here. We're holding back, looking for a gap to come in at speed.
Oh, it's too small a gap, Ben. Surely you're not going to fit through there. Surely that's too tight.
Unfortunately, as we committed, the gap obviously just disappeared. We couldn't bail out, so we had to try and thread the eye of the needle, and we didn't quite make it.
Big incident. Oh, that's a penalty. Yeah.
Sorry, guys.
As they come up to mark number 1, it is Denmark once again in the lead. Great work by Sehested. Denmark on the French Riviera getting the victory in race number 5.
Good job, guys.
And then there were 3. Two of the fieriest characters in SailGP, Spittle and Robertson. They've got history together.
And Outeridge, deadly in the light winds.
This is the grand final.
Spittle turns towards the line. Outeridge is late. Hey! Spittle nails the start. And who finds the next gust of wind could determine who wins here in Saint-Tropez. There will be a split now. Who's guessed right as to where the breeze is?
As soon as it goes shifty, I'd back myself to get it right the majority of the time. My entire childhood, I grew up sailing in unstable wind. I guess if you've done that for the first 15 years of your sailing life, you get pretty used to analysing what's going on as second nature.
The wind is changing direction all the time.
Looks like the Japanese have got good pressure.
The Americans just fell into an empty pocket of wind. Phil Robertson of Spain have pushed into second place, but the French Riviera will belong to the Japanese. Congratulations, Japan, SailGP, as they claim the France Grand Prix.
The women's pathway programme has been evolving throughout the season, and there's increased talk about a significant rule change that would see a female athlete on board each boat during racing.
Since the beginning, my role has evolved a lot. Now I feel more and more one of the team. Also, I did some flight control, so I really practice all the calls. I understand much better the boat. You have to be focused 100%. All the time. And so at the end, it was feeling.
Well, I don't see that there is any different than women sailing the F50. In the last 3 positions, being a driver, being a wind trimmer, or being a flight controller, it's not a physical demand that we can't do. There is a lot of women sailors who is ready to take that challenge on.
I think the evolution is going in the right direction. It's going to grow and grow, and it's going to be unstoppable.
SailGP heads to Cadiz, and there's been some big changes since Saint-Tropez.
So the stage is set, and it's not just the usual crews on board this week, with the female athletes joining for all races for the first time.
Billy Besson has been fired by the French, and he's been replaced by Quentin de la Pierre.
Well, the pressure's really on for the Spanish team. There's massive local support, the presence of the king, so the stage is really set.
But can Phil Robertson and his crew reign in Spain?
I don't think the pressure's going to hurt us. It's going to be something that's going to fire us up. And for me, you know, I'm a Kiwi. At the moment, I'm an adopted Spaniard, and this is our hometown. And yeah, we're going to want to put on a pretty good showing.
Who's got the timing right? There we go. Oh, and it's Spain in front of the home crowds, leading at mark one. The pressure's on the Spanish here, and they're delivering.
SailGP's never seen anything like it. Thousands of people on the seawall. It's like a natural grandstand.
It's like the Champions League has come to Cadiz.
Great work by the Spanish. They're really good at getting this boat up onto the foils. The crowds are getting an incredible view here. Look at the numbers on the shoreline.
Vamos, España! Ahí está! Victoria del Vasco Español!
Vamos!
Victoria and Phil Robertson con tres del botín, Canona, Marbel, Andrea More.
It will be Spain, SailGP, that wins race two here in Cadiz.
Rock solid. I guess that's what it's like to play in a stadium. It was, pretty incredible, actually. To have so many Spanish out here supporting us is one of the coolest things I think the whole team's experienced. There's big breeze coming tomorrow, so it will be, a bit of a wild day, I'd imagine. So, yeah, maybe some capsizes as well.
We've had plenty of action already today. This was Spain SailGP during practice.
They capsized at close to 90 kilometers an hour.
Look at the crew fall into the wing there. Wow, lucky, great. We know that everyone was okay.
It's a race day, and we did it in Denmark, and we've done it here in Cadiz, so it's bloody disappointing. And we've got a lot of work to do to get this boat ready for the next one.
We're just about set to go for the final race. Three boats involved, Australia, Great Britain, and the United States.
The final. Spithill, Slingsby, and Ainsley, three big punchers.
All looking to land that knockout blow.
Here we go. The fleet's clear, but Spithill must drop back. Ainsley, he should lead from here at mark one, but how brave are you feeling, Ben? They're flying too high. They're going to slip. They've stuffed it. This could be over. Capsized.
So now it is two boats battling for the title as Australia sails away.
Oh, and there's a problem with the American boat.
You know, when Jimmy Spittle's in a final, weird stuff happens to his boat.
Congratulations, Australia takes the Spain Sail Grand Prix.
That was insane out there. We knew it was going to be a full-on day when we heard the Spanish went over trying to get out to the racetrack. Yeah, we're stoked. I'm happy we're on form and we're heading into Australia in the lead.
Capsizes, crashes, it's the closest, fastest racing on the water. It's the real deal.
Two events left. Next stop, Sydney.
I think one day we'll look back at it and say, man, that was a lot of fun. But right now, it's a pretty serious business.
Next time on The Spirit of Yachting, a true epic of offshore racing, the Rolex Middle Sea Race.